meeting started. We have the cameras all ready to go.
Is the hangup up?
Yours isn't though.
Is the hangup up?
It will be as soon as I sit down. So it gives me great pleasure to welcome Marlon Dutra. He and I have been friends for about 11 years, almost 12 years. And he was here about 4 years ago talking about large-scale deployments of LTSP in Brazil. Yes, that was. We were all impressed because he had 1,200 users, and now he's got 1.2 billion. So I'm going to turn it over to Marlon. He's going to tell us all about Facebook and how it works and what's going on there. So thank you.
Well, hello everyone. It's a pleasure to be here again. So last time I came here to talk about the LTSP cluster I used to manage. I'm not sure if it's still alive because we don't have that much access to it. But today I'm going to talk about something bigger. And so in addition to the OpenSSL bug, I would strongly recommend everyone to replace the private keys as well. So there is a big possibility that the private keys have been leaked. So not only the certificates. Like I think that most of the CAs will, if you have your certificate signed by a CA, like VeriSign, they will probably resign their new certificate for free. Or at least for a very low fee, not the usual price. Because this bug like, is so big. So they are collaborating to give new certificates. But don't just get a new certificate out of the same private key. So generate a new private key, a new certificate request, and then send to them, you know, sign that new private key. So this is pretty important. So it's probably as important as updating the OpenSSL. And we did this on Friday. So Friday we worked basically the whole night. So Saturday we have like 3,000-4,000 load balancers that terminate the SSL connections. And we update all of them basically at once. It was like all hands on deck to fix this problem. So, and not only this, we update the whole thing and we basically expired all our keys, create new keys, and we got them signed the next day. So Facebook is completely present. So I'm gonna talk about an hour, more or less. And I'm gonna open for questions. So if you guys have any questions, feel free to ask me. There's a lot of stuff, so I don't expect everybody to understand exactly what I'm saying. If it's too confusing, just raise your hand and ask me to explain in different words. But I'll try to be as easy as possible in the things that I'm gonna talk. So first of all, I'm gonna talk a little bit about history. It's very short, just for you guys to have a sense of how things started. Basically, most of the projects back then, 2004, when Facebook started, 2003, most of them started as this architecture, Linux, Apache, MySQL, and PHP. It's not this today, but it's still similar. So there is a lot of stuff that is still in it. And then most of the sites, when they start and they grow, one of the first things that people did in the past, and some people still do today, they just add new servers and they use DNS from run to load balance the servers. It works well if you have like few servers. So if you have like, let's say 10 servers, 5 servers, you can pretty much, whenever people ask for your hostname, instead of one IP address, respond server. Today we do not do that anymore. If you try to host www.facebook.com, you get just one IP for just one IP service. And I'll tell you guys why. So this is the way it started. So they added some servers. This is pretty crap because if you lose a server, there's no health checking mechanism. You basically will black hole some of the traffic. So in this scenario with two servers, if I lose a server, I'll black hole half of the traffic unless I assign the band IP address to another host. And one of the things that Facebook did in the past in 2004-5, well, I think we started growing. They needed more and more servers. So instead of using www, they started using subdomains, like harvard.thefacebook.com, stanford.thefacebook.com, EA, or those. Those domains still exist. So if you access now harvard.facebook without the Facebook, harvard.facebook.com will still redirect you to the www. So this is a legacy. So this is the way they...
Probably try to get you to slow down. Try to get you slow down a little bit.
Yeah. And so basically, this is the way it was in the past. Another thing that they did, and if you look at this Harvard and Stanford, they have a 3-hour difference in time. time is up. So the peak times were 3 hours apart. So they moved servers to attend one of the subsites, depending on the hour of the peak. So this was all manual. They did this every day. So of course, like all of this, fortunately, is done, and to date, most of the system is automatic. And one of the basic things that people do today, they will separate the front end from the back end. So Facebook didn't start that way. It started everything with the same server, and as it grew, they separated the back end. So basically, the front end would run Linux, Apache, and PHP, and MySQL would be a separate server. So this remains to this day, but it's a little bit more complex. So basically, today we're going to talk about front end. The back end is very complex, so we need like a separate talk to talk about it. Probably more than one talk. So we're going to focus on front end and how we route users to the Facebook front end clusters. And there's a lot of history in this since 2004 to now, so I'll just jump to now. I should have a thing. Before going into details, so this is our traffic in a weekly cycle. So the whole cycle that we have in Facebook is weekly. So if you look at this graph over the months or over the years, they repeat like every single day. So the shape of the graph is the same every single day. And so basically we have our peak day every week is Monday. So Monday is the day that we aggress more traffic from the system. And then the traffic will slow down. Saturday is the best day for us. So usually if you have a big maintenance and want to shut down the cluster, we can do a Saturday because the traffic is much lower.
What time of day are those daily peaks?
I'll show you the next slide. And Sunday, it gets much higher. Here is the ingress. If you notice here, the ingress on Sunday is bigger than the ingress on Monday. That's the business day. The theory behind it is that most people do a lot of stuff in the weekends and they publish all the pictures on Sunday evening. Mm. And then Sunday evening we have a lot of traffic coming, even in every time zone. We have a lot of traffic in video uploads and photo uploads. And so all those people upload the pictures here, and most of those pictures we get seen on Monday. So that's why you have the opposite on Monday. So on Monday morning you go and see Facebook and you see like the big flow of pictures that people publish here on Sunday evening. So this happens every week. It's the same thing every week. If you look at the daily cycle, and just one single day, it looks like this. This is the global traffic in the Pacific time zone. So for us, the global peak is between 11 a.m. and 3 p.m. That's very convenient for us because we have all people in the office. So usually people get there like by 10, and we leave like 5, 6, 7. So it's very convenient. Usually most of the problems related to traffic, they are in the peak time because all the clusters are not melting because we have spare capacity. They are really pretty hot. So this is pretty convenient. Of course, it was just connected. If you were in a different time zone, this is the combination of all time zones. So this graph alone doesn't make sense. But if you look at this graph against the map, it kind of makes sense. So basically, when we start the peak here, basically it's when this region of the world here is getting too big. So we have the Pacific Ocean that there's virtually nobody there, so the traffic is very low. It starts to ramp up. And then we get basically the first map here is when this all this region are in peak. So we have like millions and millions of users in Indonesia, we have like almost 100 million users in India, Korea, Japan. Are all pretty big, but they are not nearly as big as Europe. So when Europe starts getting peak, and usually the peak in each time zone is in the evening. So like by 7, 8 p.m. That's when the specific time zone. And then when Europe gets in peak, that's when we have this problem around here. And then, so there's only 3 hours of difference between the East Coast of South America and Europe. So basically in the East Coast of the US. So usually when this side is finishing the peak here, so basically this is GMT. So when this is finishing the peak here, the peak starts here. So basically we get most of this stuff together in peak. That's when we hit like maximum amount of capacity serving people. And then it goes down. It goes down because Europe goes to sleep, so this here is right overnight. And then so it goes up again. It goes up again because we have the second peak, that's the West Coast. So there is too many people here. So the East Coast is still big because it's only 3 hours apart. And then we have few people here living here in this portion of the country, and then the peak comes here in Mexico. And then it goes down because like there is only Hawaii and some islands here. So there's not too much traffic. And then this happens every day. It's very nice for us because it's very predictable. So we can have alarms along the shape. If anything happens and the traffic starts moving down or moving up, we have alarms that fire telling us that there is something wrong. Of course, the alarm doesn't won't tell why. We have other problems to cover. But usually when we have the worst problems, the first thing that everybody notices is that traffic goes down. So if we have like a message outage or like a newsfeed outage, the total traffic will go down immediately. So we have some dips in the graph. I don't have any graphs to show you, but we have some pretty bad dips sometimes. We never got to zero. So I've been there for almost 2 years, and we never got like an egress drop that went close to zero. So the worst that I have seen was like 30%, because the infrastructure is so distributed that it's virtually impossible for everything to go down at the same time. If you look at a specific time zone, let's say the Eastern time zone. So the graph looks a little bit different. So we have the first peak around 1 p.m., and then it goes down, and we have a second peak around 8 p.m. This varies a little bit country to country. If you look at South America, it's a little bit later, the peak. It varies along the year. So if the sun sets later, the peak will be later as well. And then I think by this time of the year, the peak next time zone is 1 p.m. So it kind of makes sense. So usually people around noon, they got access to a lot of Facebook because they are in lunchtime, and then they go back to work, and then they get home and they access a lot of Facebook because like they probably don't have some time. And so this repeats every day. If you look at the 24 time zones, it basically will be the same thing, just with the hours shifting one side. In terms of numbers, when you are at peak, like noon or 1 p.m. in Pacific time, all the cluster sun, we're getting around 13 meters requests per second. And 4 or 5 meters of them is pictures. So basically, we are outputting 4 or 5 meter pictures per second. And we keep a lot of established connections. So when you access Facebook, your browser will keep established connection for a few minutes in case you need to put more stuff. And most of the cell phones, if you use Facebook Messenger, the Messenger will permanently keep a connection established with us for the notification. So we don't need to use the push notifications from Apple or Google. But we need that. We use this if your phone sleeps, because then our app can't communicate anymore. But if the phone doesn't sleep, we keep an established connection. So during peak, we have 206 million established connections. That's a lot of memory. And that's one of the main reasons we have so many loadouts. Because each connection costs, I don't know, 1K, 2K to keep that stuff. So this is pretty aggressive. Yes, established. Yes, it's pretty aggressive. But that doesn't cost CPU. So when you want to keep like established connection, it's just memory. If the problem is RPS, RPS costs a lot of CPU, especially small requests. So when you access Facebook, each profile picture, each CSS or JavaScript, anything that were requested from the site is a new request for us. So that's why you have so many requests per second. That costs lots of CPU. And then that's the second reason that we need to have a lot of load balancers, because otherwise they wouldn't be possible. So the monthly active people global today is 1.23 billion. So that's the number of people that have accessed the site in the last 30 days. We just hit 1 billion in mobile, so the traffic is shifting pretty aggressively to mobile in the last few years. And then we need to adapt the infrastructure to this, because mobile is horrible. And when you serve desktop, it's so easy, because most of the people, they have wired connection at home, they have like cable modems and ADSLs. When you go to mobile, most of the traffic is coming from 3G, 4G networks. And here in the US, we have like a good network in most of Europe. We have good networks, but when you go to the third world countries, it's pretty bad. So it's a lot of packet loss. And
some acronyms up there I don't know if everyone of SPD.
Monthly active people and daily active people, DAP and MBB. Which one?
Okay, so SPDY.
Oh, SPD. SPD is the new protocol that Google is trying to replace HTTP. So we support both HTTP and SPD in our front end proxies. So most of the traffic, most people are using Chrome today. And usually Chrome, when the server supports SPD, the Chrome will talk SPD to us instead of talking HTTP. It's much more efficient. So you can multiplex the connections, and it's much better for both sides. And the HTTP 2.0 will probably replace SPD. So the draft of HTTP 2.0 is basically based on the SPD.
And what was MAP and DAP again?
Oh, MAP is monthly active people, and DAP is daily active people. People that have access to Facebook in the last 24 hours.
How do you determine if somebody is mobile or not? What's your definition of that?
In the user agent, basically, the requests. When you get the requests, even from either from the browser or from our native applications, we can determine from the user agent. If the user is coming from Android or iPhone, are coming from Google desktop.
So a tablet, do you call that a mobile device?
We call that a mobile. We call it a mobile.
So an iPad is a mobile device?
iPad is a mobile device, yes, that's right. It's a mobile device.
Do you have a sense for how many people are using the Facebook app versus?
Yes, we have the numbers definitely, but I don't have it here. So I think it's probably half of this or something like this. Because smartphones are super common here, but when you go to third world, it's not that common. So there's a lot of people using the m.facebook.com. So that's more than 200 million people. We call it M site. So daily we have 757 million people using the site. That's not all at the same time, because we have people around the world. So even in peak, when we're in peak, it doesn't mean that we have 700 people access the site. We have much less. 80% of the users are outside the country. So that's pretty, we have 170 million users here, so close to 200.
170 million?
Yeah, it's more than half of the population.
320 million people in the
US. Yes, it's half the population, a little more, I guess. And, but 80% of the users are outside the US. So this poses a big challenge, because the network's out there, and in several countries are pretty horrible, so the apps, they need to handle this pretty well. And 73% of the users are mobile. This is growing more and more and more. So eventually we'll get to 80% or more. We'll never be 100%, you'll get close to it. And we have, I don't have the number here, but I think that we publish. We have a number that tracks the number of people that's mobile only. So people that have never accessed the site through a desktop. They always access mobile. That's very common in developing markets. So if you go to India, I think India has 1 billion plus people and inhabitants, and we have only 100 million users. So there is a huge potential for growth. And most of the growth in India are mobile. It's really interesting. So that's why the company is focusing a lot on the mobile side of the infrastructure. So the infrastructure. So basically, we have now 4 big data centers. So we have Prineville, and we have Virginia, this is Oregon. We have Virginia, Virginia, Ashburn, Virginia. We have Forest City in North Carolina. We have a new one that will be the biggest one here in Iowa, very close to Des Moines, in a city called Altoona. It's by the I-80. And we have this one in Luleå, that's in north of Sweden. It's just 35 miles off the Arctic Sea. It's super cold. This new data center, both Prineville and this here in Sweden, we don't have air conditioning. We just pull air from outside. That's enough. Because it's very cold. And all the specifications of our data center are public. We have a project called globalcompute.org, where we publish the specification of all our servers. Now we have switches and storage, and the whole data center, all the air conditioning, all the airflow system, and all the thermodynamic system. It's very, very nice. We have very, very good data center people working there. And this, I think that we start sending traffic here probably by the end of this year. This is going to be pretty big.
So
is it all the data centers?
Yeah, that's all.
Nothing in Asia?
Nothing in Asia. But they are big.
So if 80% of your traffic is from outside the United States, why are all your data centers in the United States?
Cost.
Yeah.
Having a data center here is still much cheaper than the rest of the world.
Really?
Much in power, because we have most of them are clean energy. So Prairie View, there is a hydro plant very close to it. Iowa will be all wind power. And Ashburn is not ours. We rent the place, so we don't have control over it. And North Carolina has a hydro plant close to it. So the power is cheap, and the telecommunication and large bandwidth is much cheaper than the rest of the world. And that's what I think eventually we start having data centers somewhere else.
So how large, you say it's very big, how large is your new
one? We have more than 100,000 servers there.
100,000 servers?
More, only this one. Yeah, Iowa would be bigger. So yeah, it's too big. We start building smaller data centers in the future. Because it's too big, it's difficult to manage. So this data center here, it's 400 yards from end to end, each one.
Wow.
Yeah, it's huge. People bike inside the data center, because you can't walk. It takes several minutes to walk. So yeah, we have bikes in the data center. So if you call cyclists because you have a problem in the server, they will bike to fix it because it's too big. I've never been there. I'll be there in May or June. So we schedule a trip to go there. And so in this Prime, we have Prime 1, that's the first one. And we have Prime 2, that's an exact copy of the first one. And this is Prime 4. I don't know why this came, the 3. So this is the 4. So this is only cold storage. So this is a lot of storage capacity to hold logs, records, things that we don't need to access too often. And it's too expensive to store that data in like spinning disks all the time. So the cold storage, all the specification for the cold storage is open as well. So we have like 1 petabyte of data per server. And we have lots of servers. It's pretty insane.
Well,
and,
how big are your servers?
We have 5 schools. And I think now it's 6 with the cold storage. So it varies from a lot of CPU, a lot of memory, a lot of disk, a lot of I/O capacity. So we vary them. I think the most powerful ones, it's today would be like 200 gig of memory, 40 cores or 32 cores, and either spinning disk or flash, depending on how much I/O.
Intel processor.
It's all Intel. It's all Intel. We've been trying other stuff, but nothing actually. So basically today it's all Intel. We've been using the Ivy Bridge processors lately, so they are super good. You can go pretty much close to 90% and they're still going very fast.
Tell them about your server.
All of us, we have a dev server, so I don't work on the laptop. I only use my laptop as an SSH client, which is a browser. So my dev server has 146 gigs of memory, 40 cores, and 2 petabytes of things. And that's my dev server. It's a bare metal, it's not a virtual machine. So we don't do virtual machines.
What? Are you going to bury that because of tornadoes?
Yeah, actually.
Not the Oregon one. I mean the Iowa one.
Yeah, the whole reason of having 3 data centers is this problem. So we have earthquakes here, we have hurricanes here, and we have tornadoes. So actually, we can protect from the whole stuff. And here it's pretty calm actually. So actually, the whole strategic plan for distributing data centers around the country is to protect from different things. When we have the same hurricane last year, I guess, or 2 years ago, we had to shut down the whole Ashburn because of this. Not because we lost the data center, but we lost transatlantic capacity because some of the fibers have been cut. And we didn't have enough bandwidth out of the data center, so we need basically to move the traffic away because it was too bad. And when we had a couple months ago, or last summer, we had a heat wave here. No, we had the cold cycle. And the North Carolina Power Authority, whatever, they asked us to reduce traffic there because we consume a lot of power, megawatts. And Google has been attended very close to us. And they called us and they asked, hey, can you guys reduce the power consumption because we are like melting the system? And we shift most of the traffic to the other side of the country to relieve a little bit the power consumption. And we saved them like 300 kilowatts or something just by moving traffic to another center. So we have things happening everywhere all the time. So it's good when you have capacity like spread around the world. So like whatever happens, like nature events or like cold or hurricanes or whatever, we can move traffic from here to there. And as we have more and more data centers, there will be pretty much.
Does that mean that you have everybody's data in every one of the
yes.
centers?
Yes, today, yes. We want to.
There are mirrors of.
We have full mirrors in all the data centers. We don't want to keep that forever. Because each data center needs to be as big as the next one, and that's too expensive. So this data center in Iowa will cost us like almost $2 billion.
$1 billion?
$2 billion.
Wow.
Because it needs to be as big as the previous one, because it needs to copy everything. And so this model, we will have to break this model eventually and have smaller data center with standard data so we can have smaller and cheaper data centers.
What's the pipe like between the data centers?
Terabits. Several terabits. Yeah, and it's all, most of the links are 10 gigabits. And we are starting deploying the first 100 gigabits now. So we are one of the top five customers from to Juniper and Cisco to deploy the first 100 gigabit interface. We already have 100 gigabit between two data centers. And so we have a bunch of them. And we just use Rust, and BGP to use all of them at the same time. And the whole network. So in the beginning, we had only two data centers. We had Ashburn, that's not our data center, but we rent for space. And we had one data center in Santa Clara that we are fully decommissioning this year because it's too expensive. The square foot is very expensive, and the power in the Bay Area is the same expensive. That's everything else. Everything is expensive. So in the beginning, basically, we separated the world in east of Mississippi and west of Mississippi. So it was pretty easy to route, just GeoIP, and we route like users to one data center or not. And so basically the west side would cover the whole Asia, and the east side would cover South America and Europe and Africa. So it was super simple. But now, things are a little bit more complex. So besides the data center, we have a lot of edge locations, where we have a couple servers, like 80 or 120 servers. And they're very small, just usually 10 racks or 8 racks. And we have 25 of those. This is growing pretty aggressively. So we have a new hub coming every month or every 2 months. And then we have, basically we have them throughout the world. We have Africa pretty soon, we have one in Australia pretty soon, and we have more South America, Argentina is coming. So basically, when we terminate user, we are not terminating user directly to the data. We usually route all the users to POPs, so you establish your SSL connection there, and the TCP connection, and then from the POP data centers, we have big backhauls of a huge pool of established connections. That's much faster. I'll explain that a little more in the next slide. So this is now is 2020 something. So when we have a lot of data centers or a lot of POP, the main challenge is where to route each user to which POP. So this looks simple when you look from a geographic perspective, but not everything relates to geography. So we have like countries like Japan and Korea. They are very close geographically. But the connectivity between the countries is very poor. So usually they talk to each other by going to the countries and coming back. So we need to take that into consideration. And so basically, when a user needs to talk to Facebook, the very first thing that you need to do is to translate the www address to an IP address. That's the first thing that you also do when you type www. And so you talk to your ISP's DNS server. The DNS server possibly will have their IP address, their host name cached, but we send like 2 minute TTLs, so we will expire pretty soon. And then the ISP DNS server will talk to our DNS infrastructure through the server. And then our infrastructure basically is not a simple DNS server. It's what we call a DNS load balance, or a global load balance, also known as GOB. So this is the first layer of load balancing, the DNS level. And so if you run post www.facebook right now from here, it's very likely that we're going to route you to the POP in Chicago. That's the closest. Because we know a lot of stuff, like the ASN that you were coming from, and the GOAP, and a lot of other data. I'll talk to you more about it next. And then the DNS will do all the calculations super fast to respond to you the address. The same thing for IPv6. And it might happen that we route IPv6 to a POP and IPv4 to a different POP because the internet, even with the internet getting dual stack now, we don't have the same amount of different routes that we have in IPv4 for IPv6. So once you have the IP address, the next thing that the browser will do is to establish the connection, to
establishing an HTTPS basically.
So then we talk with the layers of load balancer here. So we establish the connection, then we send a GET to the load balancer. The load balancer usually has a big cache here. So if it's a static content and the content is the cache, the load balancer will respond to the request itself. Otherwise, it needs to proxy the request.